Hi, and welcome to this installment of Bergeron Briefs. For those of you who haven't seen the show before, my name is Art Bergeron. I'm an attorney at Myrick O'Connell. We're a central mass firm. There's about 60 of us. The other 59 do something else. I do elder law. I started doing these shows really to kind of supplement the work that I do doing presentations at the Salt Marsh. When I am there, I try to talk more about the legal issues that might be important to people with seniors. The purpose of the show is to introduce you, if you're a senior or know somebody who is, and that's just about everybody, to the people that you ought to know here on Nantucket if you're a senior. One of those people is David Wirth. So thank you very much for coming on.
I'm delighted.
And it was wonderful to find out in preparation for this, I just did the usual flip, so when did you show up here, right? And you said, oh, well, no, actually, my family's been here since when again?
Well, 1662.
The 1662, a long time.
So I'm a 12th generation Nantucketer.
Although you told me your brother makes fun of you because you actually weren't born on the island, even though he was. So you're kind of like really. On the birth certificate, it doesn't say.
It doesn't say that.
It doesn't say. So you're kind of there's a birther issue around.
Apparently.
So thank you for coming on. So you born here and grew up here and then kind of went away for a long time?
Yeah, I did.
But you've now been back for how long?
Well, my family, we've been back since probably about 85. We've been fortunate enough to have a summer home here.
Yeah.
And then my wife, Leslie, and I retired here in 2013. I think we're coming on our third full year here.
Yes. And, so you don't mind winter on Nantucket?
I don't.
That's really the bar, you know. If you could do it in January, you know.
And
by the way, I'm from Off Island, so I've been here in January. This wasn't fun.
Well, that entitles you to come back in the good weather. We moved back here, and we have Nantucket is, perhaps many of the viewers know, is becoming an increasingly attractive place for retirees.
Right.
And there's aside from a very robust cultural community, and lots of things to do. There's some great people that have come back to the island and, have either had situations like mine or have been coming here for summers with their families and just have made Nantucket their retirement spot.
So. And I've met quite a few people here that were just an amazing group. And once again, I love the Salt Marsh. I got to love your library, though. I think that's the most vibrant public library that I've ever seen in terms of both, obviously they've got books and they've got other stuff, but the amount of things that happen at the library.
Their programming is fantastic. It's hats off to the person who does that programming.
Yes.
So there's a lot of that, going on, which, for older adult seniors who are contemplating whether Nantucket's a good place to be, you can maintain a pretty, vibrant both social life as well as intellectual life.
Being here.
Now, that doesn't mean that people don't get off in February and March to warmer weather.
Right.
But
although they don't complain about the internet service sometimes. I have to say sometimes. Although that's just part of the allure is that you can really tell people when you're on Nantucket, oh, I'm sorry, I can't do that call.
But that's okay.
I have to go to the beach. So I asked you to come on, and I had heard about you from my friend Chuck Gifford, when he told me that you were at Sherburn Commons, right, and that you had retired there, right, that you also were one of the people, really, who became part of that core group that took Sherburn Commons from for profit to nonprofit, which I just thought was wonderful when Chuck was talking about it. So can you just talk a little bit about that? About kind of what motivated that? And how you did it.
Sure.
And then from your own perspective, now that you've done it, so now what?
Right. Okay. Well, I don't physically live there. I have a house somewhere else. So when I came back to the island, I actually got involved and appointed to the town's finance committee.
Mm-hmm.
And so I, to do some public service and have a background in that, so it was an easy thing to do. Sherburn Commons, as many of viewers know, and has had a very checkered history. I mean, it opened about 10 years ago, and it was a fabulous concept that was developed by local Nantucketers for Nantucketers as a senior community that people could, you know, retire to, be amongst peers, and you know, have a very nice, somewhat downsized lifestyle as they aged. It opened literally in 2008.
Not a big year in the real estate world.
No, and they almost immediately went into bankruptcy, which was very traumatic for the people that had put money in, individuals who had put money into the community.
So were there already people living there when it went into bankruptcy?
Yes.
Wow.
And they actually, without going into all the technical details, they basically lost everything that they had put in. They still live there, and you know, it was very, very traumatic, and of course had a big impact upon the town, because the original, the folks that originally developed the idea, people like Joan Craig, who was a beloved, you know, Nantucket person, the town gave that group 22 acres on a long-term ground lease, 99 years.
I see.
So the group didn't have to purchase the land. So they went and they built 20 cottages and 40 apartments with dining and, you know, all the accoutrements that went with building those senior centers.
Yeah.
Anyway, so they bankruptcy ensued. They got reorganized. It was bought by a company from Florida in 2009, and they quickly had a financial problem as well. And the folks that had lent them the money to buy it out of bankruptcy, which is a real estate investment trust from California, took it over. And they continued for the next few years to subsidize.
And by the way, are they all, is everything there rental? Are both the, are the cottages and the apartments all rental? Or
they are now. They weren't. The original concept was that you would buy in to your apartment or your cottage, and when you left, you got back 90% of your money.
I see. So it's almost like a co-op or some kind of an... not even like that.
I mean, it was a standard model for senior assisted living and independent living for seniors
at the time. Yeah.
And Nantucket was not, Sherburne Commons was not the only place that had problems in 08 and 09. Many of these communities had to reorganize themselves financially. So so anyway, the Real Estate Investment Trust had this non-performing asset, as they called it. They were putting a lot of money in to subsidize it and were looking to sell it and get out from underneath. And the town was, because the town has a ground lease interest, is, you know, has been involved with this transaction. I got actually approached by some people in the town to take a look at this. My business background was well suited to doing that. I've you know, I've done a lot of buying and selling of assets and also a lot of basically restructuring of businesses. And so I looked at it and I proposed that we convert it back to a not-for-profit organization. So it started as a not-for-profit when Joan Craig and that team built it. Then it flipped over to a for-profit status when it was bought by for-profit companies. And then I proposed that we go back to a not-for-profit status. So in 2014, negotiated the purchase of the property from the Real Estate Investment Trust, formed a not-for-profit organization, and in January 7th or whatever of 2015, we took over operation. And
So the nonprofit's been, it's been operating in that form now for a year and a half.
18 months, And we were able to, so we made some, you know, we did the usual business things. We were able to be cash flow positive in the first month. We've been cash flow positive every single month we've been in operation. And while my board doesn't want to quite say that we've turned the corner, because sometimes things happen, we're actually operating in a very a financially stable and good position for the first time.
Now, do you mind my asking, how did you do that? Right, that that you became cash flow positive after buying from for-profit that was dying, right? or is that confidential?
No.
It's like a lot of Donald Trump, like a trade secret. I just did it. You know?
Well, a lot of people ask me that question, and it sounds so very trite, but the best way to describe it is there's a lot of blocking and tackling that goes on in business. And it's not very, you know, it's not very sexy. It's not the long pass. But, you know, you have to do a lot of little things, and you have to pay attention to the details.
Yep.
And
sounds like my restaurant clients. They always describe it.
There you go. Yeah.
It's a million salt and pepper shakers and food, right? The price of the food. It's a million things. Right?
And with that comes an improved accountability, you know, among, you know, from the staff. And so that's fundamentally what we engaged in. And then, of course, because it's real estate, occupancy solves a lot of problems. So we got our occupancy up a little bit in 2015. We had it drop off at the end of 2015, and now we're almost at 85% occupied, which the place has never been.
I don't remember my friend Chuck Gifford ever talking about those kinds of numbers.
No, we're very fortunate. We've worked pretty hard over the past basically two quarters. We have a younger senior cohort that's moving in, so you know, which is will give some additional vibrancy to the community, and so anyway, we've definitely turned the corner, you know, so for that I'm quite grateful it's turned out that way.
So I was going to say, just from your perspective now, obviously you got to be happy about that. Now, so going forward, how do you imagine Sherburn Commons evolving from here? Is it a matter of just kind of tending to your knitting and just making sure that what you're doing is working? Or do you imagine any other changes to Sherburn Commons?
Well, it clearly continuing to attend to the knitting is appropriate. I think if demand is there, we would probably like to expand down the road, but we would only do it if we were pretty convinced that demand was there, so we don't get into, you know, the kind of financial problems that the other teams have had. Beyond that, as you may know, there is an increasing focus on providing care for seniors in their homes. And one of the concepts that we've talked with, and I've talked with many of my people now that I've met that are in this industry, is borrowing on the village concept, which you're perhaps familiar with. Our viewers may not be, but it's basically providing services on a somewhat of a modest annual fee. Where it might involve having handymen come to their homes to do work. Beacon Hill was perhaps the first and maybe most prominent of those, but it's basically, you know, extending services to seniors in their homes. Many of the assisted living communities around the country have started to go to offering, you know, their basic services they offer in assisted living in people's homes. So one of the things that we've talked about as a board is moving perhaps in that direction. We have a business called Sherburn Commons at Home.
Yeah.
We have not rolled it out, but it's fundamentally an attempt to provide, you know, fill in the service gaps here in the community.
That's really exciting for people who've seen me when I'm at the Saltmarsh, I have a make-believe couple that I always use, Frank and Mary. You may have seen one of these.
I have seen, yes.
And their goal in life is very simple. They want to die and be buried in the backyard. Mm-hmm. And I always tell people, now there may be a point at which it's just not safe to be at home. And that's where you really need to look at some other options, because no matter how good your home is, there's still snows outside, you know. But to be having the assisted living, especially because it's a nonprofit, so it has more credibility that you're not just trying to sell something to these people.
Right,
you know,
right.
To have that be kind of the anchor for those kinds of programs is, I think, really exciting. Do you when you think about that, do you think about that also in terms of getting involved in some in perhaps the home care business in terms of providing not just kind of repairs but also some actual assistance to people at home?
Yes, although I think I haven't delved too much into the home care business here on Nantucket. I know Partners was in it. It's a difficult
business.
And I'm not sure that we have the density of population to support the kind of home care that people on the mainland might be more familiar with. I'm particularly taken by the fact that technology is increasingly playing a role here.
Right.
And yes. I think there's going to be increased opportunity to provide enhanced care for people with the use of technology, and which is pretty exciting. I mean, this is partially because all of us baby boomers are getting old, but this is an area where there is a lot of investment that's taking place by the Phillipses of the world and others that are, you know, that are in this market space. And so there's some pretty interesting, you know, types of things going on.
It's really, once again, it's interesting though, having you folks kind of be at the center of that. And just this notion of keeping people connected. I mean, everybody wants to be in their house, but I see so often my clients, they never leave their house.
Right.
And for folks who've got early stage dementia, and that means their spouse never leaves their house, partially because they're too embarrassed to go someplace, but also they just don't.
Right.
And so to give people that connectedness is a terrific.
Right. And you know, I on a personal level, my mother and my father, I mean, I've sort of run on Nantucket through all the care options that really exist down here. So I connect with this on a personal basis, which, you know, was actually one of the reasons that I become interested in it.
Because you've seen it play out.
I've seen it play out, and you know how it plays. You know how it plays out. And I've seen the holes in the care, and I've seen and talk with people that come to see us and others in the community, you know, where they don't really know where to start and how to get the care. So,
right.
So I think
because it's all over the place.
It's all over the place, right? So I think there's an opportunity and again, we're doing it as a not-for-profit to have a platform and collaborate with others because for it to work on Nantucket, there are a lot of people that have to be part of it, and there are great people that are in, you know, providing the care. So it's not as though, you know, we don't have good people.
You've got some great players.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I think of Peter.
Peter McKay is fabulous. McKay. Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes, there, you have a whole set of those. Yeah. You have just some gems.
Right, right.
So can we talk a little bit about kind of, I want to say, the other end of the care? Because we were talking a little bit about this beforehand. I know, again, from the work that I do, that in many assisted livings now, they are confronted with the fact that you have an increasing population of folks who are having more severe memory issues,
right?
And then on the other end of that spectrum, you know, in the nursing home populations, nursing homes that were really designed to be almost hospitals, and treating people who really had serious medical issues,
correct.
I've also got a lot of people living there,
right,
who've got serious memory care issues.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see yourselves, or how do you see that? How do you see, in terms of those kinds of gaps in care, how do you see that playing out? I know you were talking a little bit about the so-called greenhouse model.
Right.
But just can you just talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Well, as many of your viewers may know, the town has, or the Board of Selectmen have expressed a preference for a new island home, which we desperately need. I mean, the current facility is 35 or 40 years old. It's built on a medical institutional model.
Staff is great.
Staff,
but given the facility, it's a really warm feeling place.
Absolutely.
But it's the old design. It's
right.
Old design. Yeah.
So written into the original ground lease given back to the first group of people was the town has always had the right to locate our island home on an unused portion of the Sherburne Commons land.
Mm-hmm.
And through every transaction that took place, that clause is persevered in the contract.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we are neutral about it coming to Sherburne Commons. I mean, we certainly see some opportunity, where there are some things that could be shared, not the least of which is, you know, you may start to begin to get all senior services sort of physically in one place.
They're in one place.
You perhaps can share, you know, things around activities. So there's an argument to be made that, you know, putting everything on one campus makes a lot of sense. But that's not our decision to make. The voters are going to make that decision, and that's fine, and we're 100% cooperative with them.
Now, and that said, could you talk a little bit about this? You know, I've heard this term, greenhouse, the greenhouse
right.
model. Can you talk about that concept as a residential concept,
sure.
as opposed to the way we typically think about, and the way my mother thought about nursing homes, as in, don't ever, ever send me to the nursing home, right? And part of that, now I've come to appreciate, is because we have a particular vision of that.
Sure.
Right? Can you just talk about that a little bit?
So the term greenhouse is actually a trademark name, but there was a physician at Harvard who, you know, with family in need of care and some of the work that he was doing, you know, pioneered the notion that if you have people in smaller units and you create a home-like environment, mm-hmm. They call it patient-centered care. So if you put the resident, or resident-centered care, I guess is more appropriate, if you put the resident at the center of the care, that they will, in fact, thrive because it's much more like their home. And it also, the way these are built, they're built in smaller units, mm-hmm. basically 10 rooms around a kitchen and a dining room, and then a team of staff that work consistently with that same group. And
that sounds very different from the nursing home that you automatically pops into your mind.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. And what they discovered, Atul Gawande, who is a great author and wrote a fabulous book called Being Mortal, chronicles and is...
I have an autographed copy.
Right? fabulous. Yeah. The notion that in that environment, in point of fact, your life can be certainly richer, but it also can be extended.
Mm-hmm.
The anecdotal stories of people that go into a greenhouse skilled nursing facility, expecting that, you know, they may only be there for a short period of time. They come to life, they have more control over their day, it's become an environment that is great, and you don't then feel...
A place where you'd want to live.
Absolutely.
You don't want to die.
Right. So the town has looked at that, and that goes back to a few years ago when the town had done a work group of community folks who looked at alternatives to our island home, and one of the things that was strongly recommended out of that was that the town look at this greenhouse model, mm-hmm. as a different approach to care. And so that's currently what the town's thinking about doing. And
is it your own sense that that would be a real addition to the kind of to the mix here, or that's
sure.
What is your sense?
I think it would be. You know, I am very pro greenhouse, or people want to call it a small house
yeah.
model. I'm very pro that. I've had a father who's been in the in our island home. I couldn't say enough about the wonderfulness of the staff and the folks, and about the condition of the facility. So
right.
when you see these kinds of small community living for people with skilled needs, it's pretty hard to envision that you would want to do something different. Very, very difficult. And we've had a couple of trips with some staff up to look at a greenhouse in Boston or in the Boston area,
mm-hmm.
and you know the staff come back just very enthusiastic about what it is and the possibilities.
Right, it's like people almost can't believe it.
Right. It's extraordinarily dignified. Because it's small, it's at a scale you know, that's more human. It truly is resident-centered. So, for example, if, you know, the current setup in institutional-type skilled nursing facilities, everybody eats pretty much at the same time, generally 5 o'clock. If in your little unit you decide that you don't want to eat at 5 o'clock, but you want to eat at 7 or 3 or whatever, you know, you're not rigidly connected up to a schedule.
Right.
So it's
is huge for a person at that age. Right. The eating is a big piece of your life. You know, it's what's special.
And all the food is cooked right there. So much like in your home and in your kitchen. And we all know that when you have parties or whatever, where does everybody congregate? Everybody congregates in the kitchen. And so what happens in these greenhouses is people congregate around the kitchen, and watch people cook food and have conversation, and you know there's a real engagement. So when you see these in action, you it's really hard to envision that you would want to do something else.
You know, it's so funny because just the way in which you describe it. And the way that you find yourself being energized to describe it, just I think may give people a sense of how important this may be, how this different way of looking at this for all of us, for all of us, because none of us are getting any
younger. That's younger.
I always tell people I started doing this after my mother died in a nursing home, you know, and my older brother has an early stage dementia diagnosis now, and I say could be coming.
Yeah.
So, thank you for that. Thank you really for the description, and thanks for describing kind of where, right now, where Sherburn Commons is going. I think it's a wonderful thing. It's just a wonderful thing that you and the other folks here, you know, were able to kind of take this back as a community thing, and I think it really can be a model for many people in other parts of the state.
So thanks very much for watching today, and I look forward to seeing you in the next installment of Bergeron Briefs.